As far as we can tell, if we discount the kind of legendary information, the vast majority of Jews who made their way up to Ashkenaz in the 7th, 8th, and 9th centuries were basically migrants, lots of them coming from northern Italy, primarily for the purposes of economic opportunity. The Jews had a unique set of skills, although they were still quite involved in agriculture, and we'll speak about their agricultural efforts in another class. They're very skilled in trade because they are literate, they are numerate, they have lots of contacts with Jewish communities all over the known world. So a lot of reasons why they have a lot to do with being sort of the yeast of trade. They can start trade going, they have lots of far-flung collections and so on, and with their literacy and their numeracy, and also an interesting kind of loophole in Christian doctrine, which we'll also explore later, they're able to engage in finance and to extend credit. So there's lots of reasons why Jews would be wanted in a particular territory. But bearing in mind our overall discussion right now, which is Jewry law and the idea of law as privilege rather than a right, what exactly do you do with the Jews? Where do they fit in that feudal structure that we discussed in the last video? So the answer is that Jews were basically given sets of privileges which varied from place to place, and these were often called charters. So let's have a look at one of those charters, for example, that of Rudiger of Speyer, which is dated 1084. Now, this is probably, post-dating from the Jews' actual presence there. And there are some interesting questions about, was Rudiger actually issuing these privileges for the very first time, or was he stating a reality and hoping to attract more Jewish settlement? It's hard to say. Maybe we'll get into it in greater detail later. But for now, the introductory paragraph is quite interesting. Rudiger, who is a bishop, but he is acting here in his feudal capacity as the Lord of Speyer, he writes, "When I wanted to make the village of Speyer into a city, I thought it would increase the honor of our place 1,000-fold if I were to bring in Jews." Right? Wow, that sounds so nice. Yeah, I'm flattered, right? And then the charter goes through a whole series of things that Rudiger will do for the Jews if only they move in there. Again, it's quite possible that they lived there before, and this was kind of like designed to firm up the relationship and intentionally backdated, but let's read what it says. First of all, Rudiger says the Jews have the right to have a separate walled neighborhood. He explicitly refers to the right of the Jews to self-defense, and that the wall around their community, kind of like those gated communities in Boca Raton, is designed specifically to protect the inhabitants. He says the Jews have the right to engage in commerce in city limits right up to the Rhine River, and he specifically says the wharf as well, which means that they can engage in river trade, which is extremely important. And note that, you might be thinking in a 21st century manner, like, well, what are you talking about? You can move into a town and then you open up a business. No, not like that at all. This is a medieval society where businesses are controlled by guilds, and not everybody can become a shoemaker. You have to, spend time. First, you have to be accepted as an apprentice, then you have to fulfill a number of years as an apprentice, and then you have to go to a place where you're allowed to set up a shingle on your own. People just can't start a business on their own. They have to have legal rights, or I shouldn't say the word right. They have to have legal privileges, right? They have to be granted this privilege to do so. Rudiger gives the Jews the rights to establish a cemetery. Very important, right? Jews need to have several institutions within a reasonable amount of space, and cemetery is one of them. They will not be charged a head tax on guests, meaning if a Jew is traveling from place to place and shows up in Speyer, they won't be held up at the gate saying, hey, you're not one of our Jews, you're not allowed in here, or you must pay a heavy tax, and so on. Lots of places, many centuries into the future actually, will ban Jews from traveling through their places, or will set like really artificial limits, like Venice had really artificial limits on how long a Jew could remain on the island, and so on. He says, Rudiger says, that the Archisynagogus, which is a term meaning the leader of the synagogue, has the same authority among Jews as the mayor of Speyer has among Christians, which is very interesting. Essentially, he's saying, you guys can run your own affairs with your own leader. And he specifically stipulates that the archi-synagogues can actually judge cases, again, according to Talmudic law, because they're judging within themselves. We'll speak a little later about what happens when you have a Jew and a Christian in a legal suit. What happens then? Where do you go for, redress? He specifically says that Jews may employ Christians as nurses or as servants. This was a very hot issue for at least 200 years. We're going to talk about that later when we look at how the church viewed the Jews. And also, Rudiger says that they're allowed to slaughter their own cows for their own consumption, and they're allowed to sell the non-kosher parts to non-Jews. This is a very basic Ashkenazic practice, that the sciatic nerve in the thigh of a cow is forbidden to Jews. If you read the section in the book of Genesis where Jacob is wounded in his wrestling with that mysterious angel, it says specifically in the Bible, therefore Jews no longer eat that sciatic nerve, or that particular, I'm not sure what exactly it is, Gid HaNasheh is what it is in Hebrew. So removing that particular sciatic nerve is very difficult, and it's much more convenient and has become widespread Ashkenazic practice to simply take that whole section of the cow and sell it to non-Jews because it's too hard to remove that nerve to make the rest of the meat kosher. So he says, no problem, we will buy that meat from you. He outlines some responsibilities of the Jews. They have to, for example, pay a certain amount of money coined in Speyer currency to compensate the church for some of the land that was used for the cemetery in particular. And they are in charge of guarding their own walls, so the burden of protecting them does not fall on the city as a whole. But when you look at the entirety of this charter, it's actually pretty attractive, and you can see why Jews would say, hey, there's actually a place for us here. We have a nice carved out niche for our privileges. We can live and work here in security. And in fact, this is, during the period of the golden age of Ashkenaz, certainly before the Crusades, at which point things begin to go downhill. But for now, I hope you enjoyed watching this video, and thank you very much for watching.